Let us pray. Our most gracious, loving Heavenly Father, be your children, O dear Lord, gather in our own respective homes on this day. Though it is painful, yet it is in a way, O Lord, a blessing, for we worship together with our own families. The family altar, O dear Lord, is now being revived. The family altar comes into force. The family becomes a center of worship even now. With these thoughts, O dear Lord, on this Holy Week, the second day, we submit ourselves, O dear Father in heaven, for your Holy Spirit to work in us, work in our families, work in our church, work in our countries and the nations, O dear Lord, that you alone would stand exalted as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords in this world. To this extent we commit ourselves. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. May we together go through the third order of worship service. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name.
For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations.
O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker.
For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would listen to his voice.
Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place?
Those who have clean hands and pure hearts, who do not lift up their souls to what is false, and do not swear deceitfully.
To the Lord our God belong mercy and forgiveness, for we have rebelled against him, and have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God by not following his laws, which is set before us by his servants the prophets.
The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise.
Jesus said, come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. And I will get up and go to my Father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and redeemer.
May we now enter into a time of confession. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always accuse. He will not keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he removes our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear him. Let us confess our sins in silence. May we together say the first confessional prayer.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you alone have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and a right spirit within me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit. Amen.
Amen. Grant, we ask you, merciful Lord, to your faithful people, pardon and peace, that they may be cleansed from all their sins and serve you with a quiet mind through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. The scripture lesson for this evening is taken from St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 22, verses 39 to 46. St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 22, verses 39 onwards. Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. On reaching the place, he said to them, "Pray that you will not fall into temptation." He withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done." An angel of the Lord appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose from the prayer, went back to the disciples, he found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow. "Why are you sleeping?" he asked them. "Get up and pray, so that you will not fall into temptation." Here ends the scripture lesson. Let us listen to God's word. Dear brothers and sisters, yes, we are again online on with you. And I'm sure that this Holy Week that we are celebrating, or rather observing, is a time where with our own family members, we could come to the last part of the every gospel and journey with Christ. Here is one happening that has taken place that was found in Luke chapter 22, verses 39 to 46. Ever since Jesus set his face like a flint, you know, that's what the gospel writers say. There was a point in time when the Pharisees and the priestly class wanted to kill Jesus, and Jesus at that point of time did not go to Jerusalem. When Jesus realized that his time has come, and then Jesus set his face like a flint and went into Jerusalem. And he went into Jerusalem, as we all know, and he went on a procession and on to the temple. And then Jesus, afterwards, he was preparing himself the final, you know, battle, so to say, to defeat Satan and his kingdom, to defeat sin. So Jesus prepared himself by prayer. And I'll read for you that gospel portion where it says, "And he came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him." Jesus prepared himself for his ministry at every point by prayer. You know, prayer is something which is done silently within our heart sometimes, sometimes with a spoken word. Sometimes we just look up to heaven and say, "Lord, what's happening around me?" It's a prayer. Jesus, when he spent time in prayer, he gave us a clue. He made it very well clear to humanity that an act of prayer is a serious business where we get connected to God, our Father in heaven. And Jesus, the scripture says very beautifully, "And he came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives." Now, his custom was that he would always go back to Mount of Olives. He will always go and kneel down and pray. Basically, the Jewish custom is When they pray, they open their eyes very clearly. They stand, they put up their hand, and they make prayers. But Jesus, on the other hand, was kneeling down and he was praying to God. This was his custom, a regular. And now let's ask ourselves, how regular are we in our prayers? Are we regular enough to say, yes, I have a regular communion time with my Lord and my Savior? Do we say, this part of the day, or this part of the night, this part of the morning is for my God? Is there a time that we have allotted within our hearts to commune with God? Jesus practiced something which we need to follow. As was his custom, he went to Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. And then when he came to the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. No, something very, very interesting. What does God pray to do with entering into temptation? There was a time when Jesus looked at Peter and said, Peter, Satan is wanting to, dominate you. I have earnestly prayed for you so that you would be away from the consequences that you are about to face. So Jesus said to his disciples, prayer is something that delivers you from temptation. That's what we say in the Lord's Prayer. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. So Jesus told his disciples, saying, look, you have to enter into prayer in order not to get into temptation. After saying that, he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Jesus knew what was coming. The horrible reality of crucifixion. If this is the way that I should go. And then he was looking at it with a trembling heart. He looked at his father and said, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Father in heaven said, this is the way. That is the only way. And Jesus immediately, said, nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Yours be done. My dear brothers, what do we think of prayer? Prayer is not made to a God who is very stony, who doesn't have, kindness, generosity. No. Prayer is not made to make God change his plans. Prayer is made to a loving father. Prayer is said to a loving father, not to realize my will, not to realize our will, but to realize God's will in our life. That is the truth. So when we kneel down, let us say confidently, Lord, I come to you that you can realize your will in my life. There was a story about, a true story that has happened, which I think I shared with you earlier. And there was a huge crusade that was conducted by one of the greatest preachers. And after preaching, usually what happens is many people will go to the preacher for prayer. Like that, there was many people who were in the queue. And the preacher and his team was earnestly seeking after God, praying for each one. Then came one very sincere looking young woman who came to the preacher with a young beautiful son. and said, "Pastor, preacher, I would like you to pray for my son. My son, I would like to see him as a great person. Kindly pray for him." The preacher was about to pray for him. And then the lady said, "Now just one second, preacher. Sir, please, man of God, listen to me. Please do not pray that my son should become a missionary. My son should become a pastor. Because no, I do not want him to be like that. I want him to be, you know, a very big man in the secular world." So this woman obviously had a doubt on the goodness of the Lord. She was not convinced that God, when we pray, He will always send us out this kind of a situation. But this man said, "Look, my dear lady, if you go to your mother or your parents' house, and if you say, 'Today I'm totally free, available, whatever you, my parents, you give me, I will do it,' would the parents dump you with all kinds of work that you probably do not like?" She said, "No, my parents are very loving. I know my parents. And that's why I want to be very loving to my son." And said, "If you are so, what do you think of your Heavenly Father? Is he so cruel? Is he so heartless? No, he is a loving Father. All that you say is, as you say in the Lord's Prayer, 'Let thy will be done as it is in heaven.' Let thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." You know, that confidence we should have. And Jesus had the confidence, and he turned around in his prayer and said, "Lord, I find it difficult to go through this. And nevertheless, not my will, let your will be done." My dear brothers and sisters, today, on this Tuesday, the second day of the Holy Week, we come to God, we come to Jesus as our role model, and we say, "Lord, we know the importance of prayer. We know what to pray for. You know what to pray for? Lord, do my will." No. "Lord, do your will, according to your will." Because we worship a loving Father who gave his only begotten Son. Would he not give us all these earthly blessings? He will. Why do you worry? Realizing God's will in our life should be the uppermost in our life. Somebody has beautifully said, "I would rather suffer with Christ than without him. I would rather suffer with Christ than without him." So my dear brothers and sisters, let us commend ourselves. Ask him to lead us in the path of the cross. Because following Jesus will always have a redemption, a blessing, fruitfulness to others, ministering to others, carrying on the purpose for which God has created us. As Jesus said, "I find it difficult, Lord. Nevertheless, not my will, your will." Let us pray.
Maybe together say the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. Our most gracious, loving Heavenly Father, dear children, O dear Lord, gather together
in our own respective homes this evening. Dear Lord, calling to our mind your journey towards Golgotha. Lord, you came into this world to give yourself as a sacrifice for the forgiveness of each one of our sins. And we want to thank you and praise you, dear Lord. And today, Father, as we just now heard, you, O Father, did everything according to the word of God. And you have always prayed, O dear Lord. You prayed before you took up the cross. You prayed, O dear Lord, so that you want to realize the will of God in your life. This is the role model of Father in heaven. And we were taught by the word, as was his custom, Jesus went to Mount of Olives to pray, that as Christ, O dear Lord, you have set a time, you have set a place where you constantly communed with God the Father. Today, Lord, we have lost that kind of an habit. We do not have a set time. We do not have a set place. We casually, O dear Lord, take on you, that whenever we need something, we turn to you. But, O Father, to be in an attitude of prayer and getting our families around the altar of thanksgiving and prayer to your holy name has been lost, O dear Lord, in many families. In many a home, O dear Lord, the altar of prayer was thrown away. Today, dear Lord, as we gather together as families, we revive that. We bring back that culture. We bring back, O dear Lord, a set time of prayer. And together, O Father, as families, we would humble ourselves and come to you, because this is the way that you taught us, O Lord. We thank you, Father in heaven, that this day, as we meditated upon your journey towards the cross, help us, O Father, our journey along with you is not for a defeat, it is for victory. That in the name of Jesus Christ, we are victorious in everything that we take up in our life. O Lord, our victory is not for ourselves. Our victory is for the community. Our victory is for the nation. Our victory is in order to help people, those who are in need. O Father in heaven, today, as we have heard from your word, continue to speak to us and rebuild the altar of prayer in our own respective homes, O dear Lord, that our homes would light up this witness to each other as a witness and to people who are watching us, that we seriously communicate and respect you, and that we would always turn around and say, we have King of Kings and Lord of Lords to whom we say a prayer, so that, O Father, we will fall into no temptation, that we will not end up demanding our way in our life, but we will always do your will and according to your design in our life. To this extent, O Lord, we commit ourselves. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And to God's gracious mercy and protection I commit you, the blessings of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, rest and abide with you now and always. Amen.
Life is easy when you're up on the mountain and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But things change when you're down in the valley. Don't lose faith, for you're never alone. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, He'll make them right. Still God in the night. You talk of faith when you're up on the mountain, but talk comes so easy when life's at its best. Now it's down in the valley, trials and temptations, that's where your faith is really put to the test. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go still God.